This is Alex Harvey of the Alex Harvey Band speaking. If my accent sounds a little bit strange to you, that's because I come from Glasgow, which is in Scotland. Everybody in Glasgow speaks like that. I grew up there in that city, and this track, the one you've just heard, is a kind of reflection on the streets of Glasgow. It's written in a kind of a pidgin English with phonetic spelling, the way the kids there scrawl on the walls. It's called Vambo. Vambo is like between Santa Claus and Captain Marvel coming to the rescue. Vambo is not a vandal, because Vambo knows the streets belong to him and you. Therefore, he must look after it. He lives there. I'm one of those people. I've lived in the streets. It can be a very warm place to live. People have got heart, more than maybe people that don't live in the streets think they have. Vambo is everybody's secret identity. Vambo is based on my growing up in the street. Vambo's no vandal. He don't cut down trees. Tina gaggle, Sunday go. I don't really know what that means, but it means something. It's just saying it if somebody was not illiterate, but inarticulate. That would mean something. That would, like, give some form to the language. See, it's difficult. The English language is difficult. I think it was George Bernard Shaw said that if we do not pronounce words the way they are spelled, then our children will spell the words the way they are pronounced. And it makes a lot of sense. It makes it easier to be at school then. When I was a kid, I never ever thought that I would have anything like this. A successful band drawing thousands of people into different venues, which we are doing now, which comes a little as a surprise. I always thought, though, that I would be involved in something that would be big. I always think that I can give something to humanity, by especially these kids I see in the street, because the same energy that a kid going wrong and going wild and being a bandit, if that energy goes in another direction, you can have a very useful member of this community. I think this is the same all over the world, I should imagine. As far as I was concerned, I had a great childhood. Although it was a tough place to live and it was wild, there was warmth. Like where I lived at that particular time, you didn't have to lock your door at all, because that was your part of the street, and you knew everybody else, and nobody would like steal from the man next door. When it began to get difficult was when you moved to somebody else's street. And I suppose this was all due to the overcrowding and the way things were, that anybody that lived in another street became a kind of a potential danger. I suppose that led to the gangs, the gangs meaning clan or tribe, sort of holding together. Like the Glasgow slums was really when the clans were moved out of the north after the Highland clearances. Some of them came down to the city and it became a great sprawling city. And they kept the same old traditions of the clan or the family or the gang or whatever. It meant that if you're in my side, you're okay. But if you're not, well, you might be an enemy. I didn't roam about having no place to sleep. There was my mum and dad and my brother and myself, and we lived in one room. We had a communal toilet. 100 people used it. So that brings a certain amount of togetherness, I suppose. I didn't turn out a criminal. That was, I suppose, thanks to my own folks. Like my old man, he always told me to keep out of that side of it. But then it was difficult. Going to school, you had to run with the pack, and I wasn't strong enough not to run with the pack. Anybody that didn't run with the pack had to be very, very sort of like intelligent or just superior to the way we were. But we were all scared, I suppose. I think this album definitely represents lots of the way I feel and think about things. The Impossible Dream is quite apt because I suppose it is a kind of an impossible dream. The album represents certain fantasies of mine, comic book fantasies, if you like. The next part of it, The Man in the Jar, which is the second part of the Hot City Symphony, represents to me an impression of New York. Suppose this guy that is so involved that he can't get out, but everybody can see him. That's why it's called The Man in the Jar. He's smashing the glass because he wants to get out. He is a failure. He's not really getting it together. He doesn't know how to explain it, and it's all getting too much for him. So that's why he's smashing the glass. When we're on stage, we are not so much violent as an act of violence. We go close to the edge. I am the director, and we are making a movie every night we're on stage. And we are playing the soundtrack at the same time. And the soundtrack's got to be good. That goes without saying. The band is spot on. They can really do it. Anything at all, from hard, heavy metal to a sophisticated nightclub kind of a thing. But always, it's intense. And if we can play it intense, we can act on it. I can get triggered from this. If I can feel the song, I suppose I'm really an actor rather than a singer. Although, it's still the truth. I believe it implicitly when we're on stage. I believe everything we're doing. The band is composed of Zal Clemenson. He plays electric guitar, amazing electric guitar. Sometimes they call him the Green Rubber Man. He's also an excellent ventriloquist dummy, primarily the comical sidekick. He's my feed. See, he's always looking at me, but I don't really know this. And we have little things together. Chris Glenn is on bass. He's kind of an anchor. He's a punk, really. He's a pretty one. Hugh McKenna plays the keyboards. He's the real musician, the real set of brains, that he's been brought up in legitimate musical sources. And his cousin is the drummer, Ted McKenna. And both of them read each other, like they understand each other. When I was looking for a band, I wanted a band from my own hometown, if possible. And I wanted a band that was a unit, and that we could get together with, like be a family, so that we're united against everything, because it's a tough business. I don't mean in the physical sense, I mean in the mental sense. We've got to sit like and think like one man. We can sit around in a circle and solve most problems. They were very heavy and loud and aggressive, and when I found them, it was up to me, using my experience, to mould it into something that was more direct and more penetrating and maybe even more simple. I was working in the musical Hair at the time. I was playing guitar in that. And I'd written lots of songs. And some people came and suggested I should start a band. So I looked about, asked about, and then I heard about this certain band in Glasgow. I went up to hear them, see them, and immediately we communicated. We immediately, right off. Then it was a case of working hard, really working hard. I learned in here, not because I'm speaking to America, but one thing I did learn was working with Americans, their attitude to show business I liked very much. Like, being at rehearsal at 9 o'clock meant 9 o'clock, it didn't mean 5 minutes past nine and things like that, you know, like professional discipline. And at first maybe the band thought it was being a little bit really serious, which it was, but they responded to it marvellously. The band originally was called Tear Gas, which about sums up what they were about. They were like that, sounded like a hand grenade exploding. Well, that was great, but we wanted to cover all facets so that we could still throw hand grenades, yet at the same time supply some kind of hope in it. So it must have worked, because here we are almost 2 years later. We just finished this, our third album, and it's just gone into the charts. This is Alex Harvey again, and our songs are for everybody. We get a cross-section from what the press called teeny boppers, and many teeny boppers, about 11, 12 years old. But we also get serious, whatever that means, fans of all kinds of music. We get some jazz people coming along, and we get theatrical people coming along. And we even have had something in the continent, some classical critic only ever reviewed one rock record in his life, and it was ours. That's the kind of people we want. But the young'uns are the ones that I care most about, obviously, because sometimes they get excited and they start swaying about, and I tell them not to do that and not to be naughty, and you stay still and they do it. On the other hand, you can get a band that says, okay, we're going to wreck this place. That's very easy. It's very, very easy to do that. It's much more difficult to say, we're not going to wreck this place. Because the next time that there's a rock and roll promotion, it's going to cost you more money to get in. If you cause the damage, it's their property. Personally, I don't know, and I would like to know, what I mean to these kids. I don't know whether I'm supposed to be their uncle or brother or whatever. I only know that I don't lie to them. And maybe they can tell that because they're not as silly as lots of people think they are. They're a whole lot smarter, a whole lot more intelligent. I reckon every 5 years, the kids get more intelligent, younger, despite what everybody says. I'd think it's getting better. I don't think it's getting worse. I suppose it's up to whoever listens to the band or sees the band in action to decide what is being represented. I suppose they can identify with the songs because they are all bursts of fantasy, reality, and it's about the same problems of the same people that they are thinking about, they are growing up with. Heroes, semi-heroes, gods and demigods. But I don't like to think or intellectualize on that part too much, because then I might start to try to be something else. I like to keep straight ahead. I worry that they might think I'm some kind of leader, and they don't need any leaders. It's up to them. They can be their own leader. It's no good blaming leaders, you see. This always happens, even with politicians. I don't think it's fair to ask some man to be the leader of a vast country. It's impossible, I would say. It's absolutely impossible. The man only becomes a shadow. He's killed before he's dead. It's up to the people themselves. If they always blame somebody else, then they ain't never going to get any better. And when they build up a hero, they either shoot him or they tear him to pieces, or they eat him, or they annihilate him, or they attack him without fail. Doesn't matter who it is. And I don't want that. I'm not a particularly good guitar player, but I do know where the tempo is, right spot in the middle. And that's why I've worked quite a bit, even doing sessions and things. I know kids at 16 that would like to slam their fingers in the door because they're so good. It's natural that they should get better. The standard has never been better than it is now. Some of these kids are absolutely astonishing what they can play. Now that we've achieved some kind of stature, it's inevitable that I won't do anything else but do what I've been doing. I won't take any lessons or anything like that. Try to change it, because that could change the whole flow now. Anyway, I've got the best band in the world and probably the best guitar player. Sometimes I like to play a little sometimes, but right now on stage I don't play very much at all. I said the best guitar player in the world, Zal Clemenson. Now he's self-taught, but he is a phenomenon. He's a freak. He doesn't use any formal style at all. He's just got a natural flair to be a guitar player. And on the album, Zal's featured mainly in Vambo and in Man in the Jar. The next track, Give My Regards to Sergeant Fury, features a piano player, Hugh McKenna. He plays a kind of ragtime chorus in the middle. We wrote this one because we all like vaudeville, and everybody's really a song and dance man, and it's a kind of song and dance number. It always puts me in mind of somebody like Donald O'Connor or something, or Dan Daly. It's all in fun. It doesn't really mean anything. Just give my regards to Sergeant Fury. When you see our band, remember one thing. The music is first, and then the show must go on. The one thing we do is, it must be economical. The minimum of props for the maximum effect. We won't ever use any lavish sets. Lots of it must be spontaneous. Some of the best things we've ever done have been a prop that happened to be lying about backstage someplace. Then it can be used as complete improvisation. It's got to be kept fresh. It can't be too studied. We have a beginning, a middle, and an end, which is very tight, but internally it allows me to take liberties. The band can follow me, like, at times I can go right off time. That gives me time to do something if I see something, a section of the crowd that I can work to. The band now are experienced enough to know about that and to go along with it. Zal wears a clown's makeup, but he doesn't wear it just because he wears makeup. He uses it. And remember, traditionally, a clown was a tumbler, an acrobat, musician, a comedian. He was everything. He was complete all-round. He can pull and does expression he's a mime artist really, and he doesn't know it. He only knows it now because people have told him. I reckon he was around maybe about 400 or 500 years ago. I feel things like that very strongly. I'm sure that he has been about maybe in somebody's court in medieval times. When the band and I first met, they were, and I noticed this was very strong, they were extrovert off stage and introvert on stage. We had to reverse this a little. We had to bring out what they could do. I was extroverted both places, I should imagine. So it had to be developed and brought out the dramatic side of it, to make it dramatic, to exaggerate the situation, to explain it as if we were talking to Martians or pygmies in the Congo or somebody that couldn't understand English, to get the point across, whether it was funny or serious or both together. Sometimes we don't know what way it's coming across. Some people have said that it's menacing and sinister. Well, I can understand that part of it. In discussing any kind of rock theatre, my philosophy is that it must be cheap. It must be cheap, using what you've got there quickly and efficiently to express what you believe. For instance, if somebody was going to sing a song about escaping and there happened to be a ladder line backstage, now you could use that ladder to, and then you're escaping with this ladder. Maybe bands like Alice Cooper, who I think is a gas really, I admire it very much because it's entertainment, whatever else he is. I once read that he said, why knock me for being horrific? What about Boris Karloff? And I thought that was wonderful. But where Alice's act and ours is different, I suppose, is we mean it. And we're only being theatric to express that we do mean it. Getting back to props again, ours are all cheap. We use a sheet of polystyrene and some wallpaper, things like that, an old raincoat. The minimum of glitter, we're, I suppose, a matte finish rather than a glitter finish. We want to be international, and we have found that having our pipers with us really makes things happier. Like after a gig, if we go to a hotel or something, any place at all over Europe so far, one of them pipers only has to open that case and take out his pipes, and everybody gets a communication and they wonder, what's he doing with the rock and roll band? We keep these pipers for two reasons. One, they help to spread international goodwill. Two, they're a very valid part of the act. It's no gimmick. It really is a part of the act. In Anthem, they come on. And it does help to move. It does help to move the people. It does happen to be part of the song. That's why we have them with us. Anthem is a song in two parts. The first part is a vocal, which is, I suppose, quite angry and violent. And then the second part is peaceful and non-violent. And that's the way we like to finish the act. Non-violently. This is Alex Harvey, and it's been nice being with you, and we really are looking forward to coming to America. Till then, as they say in my hometown, lang may your lum reek. And if you don't know what that means, it means long may your chimney be black, which means long may you have enough fuel to keep warm.